Let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the love and the protection and the care that you've given to us this week that has gone by. Father, we ask your blessing on this gathering, that we would worship you, that we would feel your Holy Spirit come into this place and would lift us into worship in the heavenly realms, that we might praise you and glorify your name. Be our leader, be our guide. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Our call to worship today, didn't we? From 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 16. Live as free people. Do not use your freedom as a cover or pretext for evil, but use it and live as bondservants of God. This first song talks about the songs today are all related to the theme of today, which is breaking strongholds, tearing down strongholds. And so this first one says that Jesus can break every chain.
There is power in the name of Jesus. working, waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper.
Today's message is Changing Times, continuing in that series, and the same scripture references as last week from Numbers chapter 13 and Joshua chapter 6. Got some others to throw in along the way as well. But this one is about the strongholds that are there. In our series, Changing Times, we've examined the principles of taking a step of faith. And we've looked at the changing the way that we receive and utilize resources as spiritual food. And last week we looked at how God desires us to have faith in Him as we prepare to fight the giants in the land of tomorrow. This week we continue to examine these principles that God uses us to help us overcome obstacles, that certainly there are obstacles that will be placed across your path tomorrow, across our paths tomorrow, and there are obstacles in the world around us that we must navigate or that we must participate with God as He tears down those strongholds. Looking back at our scripture in Numbers chapter 13, it says they came back to Moses. This is the first time they approached the promised land. They came back to Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelite community at Kadesh in the desert of Paran. And there they reported to them and the whole assembly and showed them the fruit of the land. And then Moses gave this account. We went into the land, they gave this account to Moses. They went into the land which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey, and here is its fruit. But the people who live there are powerful. Those are the giants and the dragons. And the cities are fortified and very large. Those are the strong. We even saw the descendants of Anak there. Now, when was the last time that you shrunk away from a task? A path, a calling, because you felt like it was too difficult for you. One of the ladies who went on the zip line tour with us. She's from Jamaica, lives in Miami, and being in the mountains is unique for her. And she agreed to go on the zip line with us. Beautiful spirit in her, a wonderful person, an excellent minister of the gospel. But when she stepped up and they latched her strapped her into the cable, she started praying. You know, I heard somebody say recently about bungee jumping, says everything is easy until you get up there and you stand on the edge, and every fiber of your body says no, and you step off anyway. After we finished, we did some of the rope bridges, and those were really the scariest thing because you're walking on a cable that's a half inch long. It felt like the Flying Melindas up there. But we had handholds, and we were strapped in above. You know, he does that without a wire, without a net, without a safety harness, just walks across the Grand Canyon, for instance. Snake Canyon. The high rises in New York City. And there were times when I wanted to stop. But Quabea was in front of me, and she had already gone. And I knew if she could do it,
I could do it.
They said about her afterward, the guy that was right behind her, coming along behind her on the ropes, on the bridges, said, you know, most of us said, as we stepped onto the wire on the first step, we said, God, just help us. Be with us. But this lady prayed every step. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, help me. Come on, Jesus. Amen. When was the last time that you stepped off the platform instead of diving in? If we're honest, we've all done it. At some point or another, we've questioned our ability to overcome. We've questioned our ability to endure difficult circumstances. Sometimes we've even wondered why God has given us so much with which to contend when we are so frail. We know we're frail. Surely He understands we're frail. Why would He give us all of this all at once? And we have to step back before we step out and begin to pray, God, help us overcome the strongholds. Help us overcome our fear, our apprehension. Jesus said it over and over again to His disciples, O ye of little faith. He says it to the disciples as they ask how it's possible for a rich person to get into the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus said, with men, it's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. God knows our weakness. But He also knows His strength. I've used this many times over the last 2 or 3 weeks as people have been talking about the circumstances of their life and strongholds that they're trying to make it through and the difficulties and the struggles that they're having. They keep saying, you know, people keep telling me, God won't give you more than you can handle. I said, you know, that's wrong. They said, well, it always feels wrong, but why is it wrong? I said, because God won't give you more than He can handle. Difficulty is learning to trust Him, to take care of Him. Strongholds, there are lots of them around. Just as the cities of the Promised Land were fortified and were strongholds for the people, you and I live in a land of strongholds. Think about the world around us and the way that they resist the truth, the life, the way, the power of God.
strongholds. Their cities are walled up. If they're listening at all, and if we're listening at all, it seems like the strongholds in our land are only getting stronger. The walls are getting higher. The separation is getting greater. The understanding is getting smaller. How many times have you heard it in the last few months? If we don't stop now, we'll lose all. The only reasonable thought is that somehow, some way, the strongholds are growing. And if the strongholds are growing, then righteousness must be shrinking. How else could we lose a nation? But then we must ask the question, is God really concerned about the nation? Or is he concerned about the individual hearts and minds and lives who are trapped in those strongholds? I've got a big list. You guys are following along in the printed version, the online version of the sermon. I got a long list. I've got a lot of stuff. I'm going to jump through those because I want to get to the solution. Right? The strongholds in America. America is a nation of division, of taking offense. And that's a spiritual stronghold because the spiritual part, and we'll talk about this more in November, but spiritual bring together. There is a different spirit that fragments and tears us apart. Division is a stronghold. The devil wants us divided. The devil loves it when Christians argue and fuss among themselves, but he loves it even more when the world begins to persecute God's people. When societies spiral out of control, he gains more control. There's a stronghold of excess and indulgence. And this might seem a bit odd, but it is essential stronghold in America when we say, I want it, I want it all, I want it now. And like the child who doesn't get what they want at the grocery store, and if we don't get it, we're going to pitch a hissy fit. We're going to lay down in the floor and have us a good old hissy. That's the way Andy Griffith described it.
That's so embarrassing.
It's what some people call freedom. It's really license. They want license to do what they want to do when they want to do it. They don't really want freedom because freedom considers the outcome and the people next door. Excess and indulgence. Romans chapter 1 verse 32 says, although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve, and in some cases, insist that everyone else approve of those who practice them. We want tolerance for the excesses in our country, unless, of course, you don't agree with the excesses, and then we're not going to tolerate you. There is, as well, a stronghold in our country today. There's a fascination with drugs and alcohol. Now, I hesitate to talk too much about this. The very first service that I ever attended in the Church of God, the very first time I ever went to a service in the Church of God, the preacher talked about drinking and smoking and playing golf. And I thought, what in the world have I stepped into? But there is a principle That is true. I'm not sure how it's happened in our world, but we've just, in our country, we've just undergone one of the largest wars we've ever had against tobacco. And then, as soon as we win that war, we begin to legalize marijuana. Makes it. It's a stronghold. And alcohol is an ever-present character in the lives of those who cannot seem to handle reality, drugs. Unfortunately, this also opens even greater spiritual strongholds and builds even greater strongholds for them. They are walled cities. Tools that Satan uses to drive a wedge between us and God. That's really what the stronghold is. It keeps us separated from the love of God. And anything that does that is a stronghold in our lives. I've listed this one as well, gaming, because, again, somehow we've forgotten that there is an addictive quality to gaming. Mm-hmm. Whether it's video gaming or it's gambling, there is an addictive quality. The next win is always right around the corner. The next race will bring wealth beyond measure. Somebody tell everyone who's gambling, the house always wins. And you can tell because the house always has a bigger house and nicer house than you. And they built it with somebody's money. These are strongholds in our land. They're walled cities. They have thick walls. No longer are we willing to look out for the good of our neighbor. We're only concerned about our choices, about our feelings, and this one about our truth. Even truth no longer has an objective standard by which we measure. There are chains that come with these strongholds. And they keep people repressed and depressed. And you know, some of these things aren't bad in and of themselves. But the Bible says moderation. The problem is, you never know when the next one will be the one that will push you over the edge and you can no longer choose. Because now, it's got you. But here's the good news. God is still in the business of tearing down strongholds. Think about it for just a minute. What did God tell Joshua to do in order to destroy the stronghold of Jericho? Go march around one time for 6 days. And on the seventh day, march around seven times. Can I tell you that the wisdom of God is foolishness to mankind? And the destruction of strongholds in our land is the same. God's power defies human logic or reason. God still breaks the addictions. God still destroys the unfaithfulness. God still brings truth to bear.
We don't have to argue with people. There are enough people out there searching for the truth. All we have to do is find someone who's willing to listen to the truth. And for far too long, the church has gotten itself walled up inside of its own castles. We're going to let the world go to hell in a handbasket while we're safe. But that's not what God called us to do. Jesus said, as you go into the world, make disciples. Called us to be on the move, to be marching around the strongholds, to be praying over the strongholds, and understand, we have to understand, that we're not the instrument that brings the walls down. I can't tear down the strongholds. I didn't tear down the strongholds in my life. God did. It was that armored man, gleaming and shining, who came to Joshua and gave him the battle plan. He's the one. The angel armies, the Holy Spirit, the power of God brought the walls down. And the army of Joshua just walked straight in. God is still in the business of tearing down strongholds. God wants us to go out and march around those places. Maybe not literally, not physically, but certainly emotionally, spiritually, to care about people who are inside those strongholds. And we're not going to destroy them. No, we're going to invite them to die to themselves and live for Christ. Doesn't make sense? From a worldly perspective, it still doesn't make sense. The way God does this, He asks us to lay down our life so we can take it up again. He asks us to put down our wants and wishes so that He can give us His. To destroy the strongholds. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says, I tell you, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Sounds like the strongholds are falling down. Galatians 6:1 says, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, if a stronghold has imprisoned them, they're caught, they're captured. You who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. And far too often, church, we try and restore that person angrily. And I think gently there means with kindness and compassion, we restore them. Not with judgment or criticism. You who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 and 12 says, to put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle, the struggle in our world today is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and authorities and the powers of this dark world in Washington, D.C. Oh no, it didn't say that. It didn't say that. It's against the powers of this dark world and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms.
It is a spiritual battle. Not against flesh and blood. Not against people whom God loves, all of them. But it's against the spirit that enslaves them. Tearing down strongholds is not a fleshly battle. Tearing down strongholds is not a political battle. Tearing down strongholds is a spiritual battle. And it is waged one soul at a time. One transforming relationship at a time. Following God's purpose and plan as we march around the walled city, day after day, until God pulls down the walls. And then we march in with the message that confounds the world and that doesn't make sense. Jesus died so you can live. But they have to be ready. And so we must pray for the walls to come down. We must march around. Sometimes we got to blow the trumpet and give a shout. But that's how we defeat the strongholds today. Just like Jericho was brought to the sea.